Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Abebayehu Mekonnen. I'm an associate professor of clinical linguistics at Addis Ababa University in Ethiopia, and I'm also a founding manager of a local NGO called FANA Ethiopia. Today, I would like to share with you some ideas about engagements with educational agencies. As dyslexia advocates, I think we need to be well familiar with matters related to engagements with educational agencies, various agencies, but in particular agencies related to education, the education sector. So my talk covers, this talk is structured in two parts. The first part covers about issues related to understanding educational policies in general, but policies related to dyslexia as well in the African context. The second section of the talk covers issues about building relationships with educational agencies. This second part will be covered by someone else, so I'll be focusing on just the first part, which is about understanding educational policies and engaging with educational agencies and stakeholders, policymakers, etc. So before embarking on the details of this topic, I think we need to answer at least three questions. The first question is about why we want to engage with these educational agencies. We need to be very clear why we want to engage. Why do we want to engage with them? That needs to be very clear for us from the outset. The second question we need to ask is, who are these agencies anyway? We need to be well aware of the various structures of the educational policies in our respective countries, in our regional organizations, and beyond. We should also be very clear about the strategies of engaging with these agencies. So what are the best ways of engagement with these agencies needs to be very clear for us. So in order for us to answer the first question, why do we want to engage with these educational agencies as dyslexia advocates? Obviously, the reason is we would like to see our education system in general to be well suited for all of our students, particularly for those with learning differences, learning disabilities. That is our ultimate goal. We want to have this engagement because we know that these agencies allow collaboration efforts to enhance dyslexia services, and this leads to better support and outcomes for children with dyslexia in the education system. So that is the general objective as to why we want to engage with educational agencies. But in particular, we know that these agencies play a very significant role in shaping policies related to special education and in learning disabilities in general. So by engaging with them, we know that we can advocate for policies that prioritize dyslexia awareness, early intervention, and support services. We also know that these agencies possess resources. So these agencies may provide resources, funding, or grants for our children, or funding grants for our initiatives that are aimed at providing services for individuals having a wide range of learning disabilities. So we need resources for improving dyslexia services, and we know that these agencies have resources. So by partnering with them, we will be able to access financial or otherwise resources to support our research, training programs, intervention or service provision for individuals with dyslexia. We also know that these agencies have expertise and resources that we would like to tap into. So educational agencies in particular often have specialized knowledge and resources focused on learning disabilities such as dyslexia. So collaborating with them would enable us to tap into their expertise to develop effective strategies and interventions. Another reason why we would like to engage with these educational agencies is because in some cases, not in all cases, but in some cases, these educational agencies often offer professional development opportunities for educators and other professionals working with individuals with dyslexia and other specific learning disabilities. So collaborating with them, we know we can ensure that teachers, school teachers, specialists working in various centers would receive training on evidence-based practices to support their students, their beneficiaries with dyslexia. We would also like to engage with these educational agencies because we know that, you know, these agencies do have, they typically collect data on student outcomes, and they also collect data on program effectiveness, etc. So when we work with them, we can contribute to the collection of data on dyslexia prevention, intervention outcomes, and best practices which can inform future efforts to improve dyslexia services. So we know that these agencies also have data in their database. We can also access or make use of those data to be able to inform our services and inform our community services, research endeavors, etc. So overall, engaging with educational agencies would allow, you know, for collaborative efforts to enhance dyslexia services, and this leads to better support and outcomes for individuals with dyslexia within the education system of our respective countries. So these are basically why we want to engage with these agencies. So the first question is addressed. We know why we want to engage with these educational agencies. Our second question is, who are these agencies anyway? Who are these agencies? These agencies are, you know, the entities that are responsible for overseeing, administrating various aspects of the education sector. So we know that in various countries we have Ministry of Education, Department of Education, and these ministries often have structures at the state or provincial levels, the city level, and we also have local education agencies or departments, regional education services, international organizations. For instance, at African Union, we have the Education Commission Department. So these are the kind of agencies we'd like to engage with. And because, like we said earlier, these entities, organizations play a crucial role in shaping educational policies, implementing curriculum standards, providing resources and support to schools and centers working with individuals having dyslexia. They also ensure compliance with regulation policies. So the second question is addressed now. The third question we had asked was, how best can we engage with these agencies? What are the best strategies of engaging with these agencies? So, as we all know, engaging with policymakers, not just in the education sector, but in other sectors as well, requires a strategic approach, and it needs to consider at a minimum their interest, the interest of these agencies, and the challenges they have. What are the challenges they have to be able to implement or to be able to push our cause? And we also need to understand the decision-making process, which we are going to discuss about in a bit. So, the best strategies from the literature, the best, you know, the strategies which are put out as best strategies for engagement are, the first one is understanding the problem well. Our problem here is dyslexia, and what are the problems? It could be a policy problem, it could be about service provision in schools, it could be about service provision in various sectors, in the social sector, in economic, etc. sector. So we need to understand the problem at hand. We need to familiarize ourselves with, we also need to familiarize ourselves with how policies are developed. So these are the key elements that are around the understanding the problem very well. We need to also understand the existing policies. What are the existing policies related to dyslexia? What are the existing policies related to education in general? We need to identify our shared goals with these agencies. What are the shared goals, or what are the common grounds that we share with these agencies? We also be very clear about the policy making process. Sometimes we approach policymakers and, you know, demand something which is not plausible according to their policy making process. So we need to follow or understand first how policy is made. We need to know who to ask and how, etc. We also need to go to these stakeholders, agencies, with solutions, not just with problems. We need to provide evidence-based solutions, and we need to tailor our message well. We know that these policymakers and agencies have their own issues. You know, they have a lot on their table, on their plate already, so they don't have much time for us. So we need to tailor our message very well, in a very concise and clear manner, so that we can make our point without any difficulty. We need to engage other stakeholders to accompany us in the process. Of course, we need to follow up and stay engaged, because these people are very busy. You tell them something today, they give you, you know, they promise to do something, but if we don't follow up, and if we are not constantly, regularly engaged with them, you know, they have various priorities on daily basis, so they may not be able to deliver. So that requires patience and persistence. So again, using these principles, we need to also have a very comprehensive kind of approach. The best approach, one of the best approaches in the process of engagement with agencies is viewing, looking at dyslexia-related policies in Africa through a system thinking approach. That is, we need to consider the interconnected elements and dynamics within the educational system, within the system in general, in our respective country, and within the educational, societal, and governmental system in particular. So viewing the existing policies, initiatives from a systemic perspective enable us to understand the problem, the barriers, and also to offer better solutions. Because when we approach a problem from various perspectives, we will be able to understand it from various angles, and that would allow us to see the challenge from various perspectives. That in turn would help us to craft solutions which can target all these multifaceted factors coming from various angles. And remember, nothing exists in isolation. That means everything is intertwined, one another, each other. So we cannot solve the dyslexia problem without understanding the societal, economical, political, you know, the entire system needs to be viewed from various perspectives. That way we'll be able to better tackle the various barriers, challenges that are, negatively impacting the lives of individuals with dyslexia. So in light of this, we need to understand the landscape. How do our policies, educational policies in various countries of Africa look like? We know that African countries share a lot in common already, but we also differ in various aspects because of our history, our culture, our politics, and socioeconomic factors, etc. So that means these differences also feed into differences in policies. So that's why we find, you know, our educational policies, our policies related to dyslexia, and other policies varying at a greater level, that they vary significantly. But nevertheless, our educational policies do still have some commonalities. If you look at the literature around educational policies of African countries, you find shared educational policy themes in Africa. The first one is about access. In all of African, especially in sub-Saharan African countries, educational policies, one of the issues which is highly dealt with is access to basic education. So despite progresses in recent years, many African countries we know still struggle with providing universal access to education, especially in rural and remote areas, we know this. So barriers to access include poverty, gender, inequality, inadequate infrastructure, conflict, etc., etc. So we have lots of factors hindering universal access to education in Africa. The other theme, which is very common in many African countries, is ensuring quality of education. So ensuring ensuring quality of education is still remains a challenge in many of African countries. We know issues such as overcrowded classrooms, poorly trained teachers, lack of teaching materials, outdated curricula, etc., contribute to low educational outcomes and standards. We know that. Another issue, which is very common in many African countries, is curriculum development or issues related to curriculum development. And we know many African countries are revising their curricula to make them more relevant to the needs of their societies and economies, because most of our curricula are, in most cases, prescribed by our donors, you know, and these curricula are not in harmony with our local context, needs and demands. So, you know, issues related to curriculum revision, curriculum development is also another common theme going around in Africa. Another issue is language of instruction, the choice of language for instruction, mother tongue education, etc. And in many countries with diverse linguistic landscapes like Ethiopia, Nigeria, etc., this is a very crucial issue, because many of these languages have not yet been reduced into writing and they are not being used in education system. And even those who are being used in the education system have quite a lot of issues related to orthography, textbook preparation, etc. So language of instruction and languages of Africa being taught as subjects is also, these are also very common themes around Africa, in African countries. Another topic is teacher training and development. Improving the quality of teacher is also a priority in many African countries. Technical and vocational education and training is also another theme which is very common in many African countries. We know that there is a growing recognition of the importance of TVET in preparing young people for employment and entrepreneurship. So many African countries are investing in expanding and upgrading these programs to address the skill gap and promote economic development. So you find a lot of policy debates around TVET. Higher education quality, primary education or middle education, higher education in Africa also faces challenges such as limited access, underfunding, brain drain, etc. And there are quite a lot of research around improving the quality of our higher education and making sure that our higher education caters for Africans to better handle their problems, to deal with or to provide solution for, you know, African solutions to African problems. So these solutions are believed to come from our higher educations, which are the center of research, intellectual debates, etc. Education financing is also another policy issue in Africa. We know that funding is a chronic problem in Africa, so adequate funding for education remains a challenge in many of our countries, our African countries. So governments, donors, and international organizations are working to increase investments in education and improve the efficiency of spending to enhance the quality of access and quality of education in general, from preschool all the way to higher education. And inclusive education has also received a growing attention in Africa, a growing recognition, because now many African countries have recognized the importance of inclusive education in ensuring that all children, regardless of their backgrounds or abilities, these children need to have equal opportunities to learn. So efforts are being made to address these barriers to education for marginalized groups, particularly children with disabilities, and as well as girls and refugees. And ICT and education also is an emerging area in policy debates, policy documents in many African countries. So information and communication technology is increasingly now being integrated in the education system across Africa. This is to improve access, quality, and efficiency of education. So providing computer labs, internet connectivity, digital learning, etc., are the issues being dealt with in many African countries. So overall, many African countries, we have made progress, in impressive progress in improving education in Africa. But as we have discussed, significant challenges still remain. So addressing these challenges require sustained political commitment, investment in education, infrastructure, and human resources, as well as collaboration among governments, civic organizations, and even the private sector. So, having said that about education policies in many African countries, I think we need to zoom our discussion into policies related to dyslexia. What do dyslexia-related policies in Africa look like? Again, like our education policies, our policies related to dyslexia also vary from country to country. Again, mainly due to differences in our education system, resource, awareness level, etc. So, some African countries, as a result, have specific policies and programs in place to support individuals with dyslexia and other specific learning disabilities, difficulties, while others may lack even formalized approach. So again, the general trend is the trends related to policies or initiatives around dyslexia include integration into education policies. So some African countries have begun to integrate dyslexia awareness and support into their broader education policies, while others do not do this, have not yet done so. So this may include guidelines for identifying and supporting students with dyslexia within their mainstream education or schools. Another trend is teacher training program, or another activity being done in relation to improving dyslexia support in many African countries is around teacher training programs. And there have been and still are lots of efforts being made to train teachers to recognize and support students with dyslexia. And most of these programs often focus on providing, school teachers, educators with strategies and techniques for accommodating diverse learning needs in their classrooms, in their schools. Another trend related to dyslexia is, or another activity widely performed widely carried out activities, advocacy and awareness campaigns, which organizations such as mine and organizations such as African Dyslexia Organization is doing. So especially non-governmental organizations and advocacy groups in Africa working to raise awareness about dyslexia among the general populace, among policymakers, educators, and the general public. So these, often these campaigns aim to reduce stigma, and they also aim to promote understanding and advocate for better support system in various sectors of their community, their country. Another activity is research development. Not all countries, but some countries are developing and or adapting educational materials and resources specifically for children with dyslexia. These, for example, include, you know, accessible books, assistive technologies, specialized teaching methods, etc., etc. So resource production, development of resources which are relevant to students with dyslexia is among the themes, among the major activities being conducted by many African countries through various agencies. Another one is collaboration with international organizations. This is done by governments as well as non-governmental organizations. And these agencies, entities, often collaborate with international organizations and experts in the field of dyslexia, again, to access resources such as funding grants, to access best practices and experiences, etc. The last trend or initiative related to dyslexia in Africa, which I would like to discuss, is legislation and legal protections. In some countries particularly, you know, governments have enacted legislations or policies aimed at protecting the rights of individuals with dyslexia and ensuring their access to education and support services. This is true just in some parts of Africa. For instance, in Ethiopia, we don't really have a policy which explicitly aims to protect the rights of individuals with specific learning differences or their disabilities. So despite all these efforts, you know, we know that challenges related to improving services for individuals with dyslexia in Africa remain a significant challenge. We know that we still have limited resources, we still have inadequate trainings for educators, our cultural barriers are still immense to understand and accept dyslexia. So continued advocacy, research, and collaboration are very essential to improve support for these individuals with dyslexia across Africa. So now the question is, for every one of us in our respective country, are there areas within dyslexia-related policies where there are no awareness, deficiencies of policies, inconsistency of policies or regulations, guidelines, or areas not adequately addressed? These are the kind of questions we need to ask ourselves. So in the context of Africa, dyslexia-related gaps may exist in areas such as identification and screening. We know that there may be insufficient guidance or resources for identifying and screening individuals with dyslexia. This leads to undiagnosed or misdiagnosis of children with dyslexia. So policy gaps in this area can result in delayed or inadequate support for these individuals. Teacher training, dyslexia specific curriculum and resources. We know that our curricula in many parts of Africa are not inclusive or are not, they do not account for, or they do not consider issues of specific learning disabilities, and they don't cater for these individuals, these children. Teacher training and professional development. We know many educators may lack trainings and supports in understanding and addressing the needs of students with dyslexia. So policy gaps may exist in the provision of comprehensive teacher training programs that, you know, equip educators with the knowledge and the skills to effectively support diverse learners. So education gaps around teacher training and professional development is very wide in many of African countries. Teacher certification, again, is another challenge. Licensing is also related to this. So teachers in many countries, you know, those who are becoming teachers are not, in many cases, are not trained as teachers. So anybody in many countries, anybody graduating from, you know, with a degree of economics or accounting or nursing can be a teacher. You know, I can talk about the Ethiopian context, you know, especially in many private schools, teaching profession is viewed as a ladder to another profession. So graduates from various disciplines, until they are able to get a job in their profession, in the discipline in which they were trained, most of them go to schools to become teacher, and they start looking for jobs which they think is the right one for them. So teacher certification and licensing needs to be really dealt with in our policies in Africa. Resource allocation, we know that, as I said earlier, we have a huge problem related to resource allocation. So we don't have adequate resources, adequate funding, we don't have adequate personnel, trained professionals, we don't have adequate assistive technologies. So these can create policy gaps in the provision of adequate support services for individuals with dyslexia. So that means insufficient resource allocation may hinder efforts to implement dyslexia policies effectively at the school and community level. Another policy gap is related to accessibility and accommodation. We know that many of our policies in Africa have gaps in ensuring that educational materials, assessments, learning environments are accessible and accommodating for individuals, you know, learners with dyslexia. Lack of guidances or standards for accessibility can also result in barriers to learning and participation for these affected students. Another policy gap area is parent and community involvement. Our policies do not adequately facilitate meaningful involvement of parents and communities in supporting individuals with dyslexia. So policy gap in this area can limit, you know, the opportunities for collaboration, advocacy, and awareness raising efforts at the grassroots level. So if policies do not provide adequate facilitation for meaningful involvement of parents and communities, we will not be able to, you know, change the cultural perception attitude of our communities. So this policy gap also needs to be addressed. Finally, we know that we need more research, more data, and we need to also monitor our policies, the effectiveness of our policies, the effectiveness of our curricula, the effectiveness of our practices in the school system and other sectors. So inadequate systems for data collection, monitoring, and evaluation, we know, can lead or create a policy gap. And we already have policy gaps around this. So that means evidence-based decision-making and accountability in our education system is difficult, if not possible. If not impossible, I mean. So we need legislation and fundings as well. So we have policy gaps related to dyslexia around, you know, many of the themes, many of the issues around policy gaps related to dyslexia are the ones we have just discussed. So what do we do with these policy gaps? We need to address these policy gaps related to dyslexia in Africa, and how do we do it? It requires a multifaceted approach involving collaboration among various stakeholders. So we need research and analysis of these policies. We need to conduct thorough research and analysis to identify specific areas of policy gaps related to dyslexia. So this may involve reviewing the existing policies in our respective countries, conducting need assessments, and gathering input from stakeholders, from parents, communities, and people working in the education, social welfare, the health sector, etc. Conducting need assessment, Also gathering input from other stakeholders, such as educators, parents, advocacy groups, etc. We also need to develop and revise our policies. We need to develop and do some revisions in cases where revisions are needed to policies related to dyslexia to address these identified gaps. So policies need to be evidence-based, comprehensive, and inclusive, covering areas such as identification, assessment, support service, teacher training, resource allocation and accessibility, etc., etc. We also need to engage various stakeholders. This is very important as well. So the stakeholders in the engaging them in the policy development and revision process is very important to ensure that diverse perspectives and needs are considered in the revision or development of these policies. So this may involve consulting with government agencies, NGOs, educators, parents, individuals with dyslexia, and other relevant stakeholders through meetings, workshops, surveys, public forums, what have you. We also need to work on capacity building. We need to invest in capacity building initiatives to strengthen the skills and the knowledge of educators, policymakers, and other stakeholders involved in the implementation of dyslexia-related policies. So this may include providing training programs, workshops, professional development opportunities focused on dyslexia awareness, identification, assessment, and support strategies. Another area we need to work on is resource allocation. We need to be able to good at raising funds, and we need to allocate sufficient resources, including funding, personnel, materials to support the implementation of dyslexia-related policies. You know, developing or revising policy itself is one thing, but in the implementation is also another important chapter. So we need resources to be able to effectively implement these dyslexia-related policies. So we need to prioritize investments in the areas such as teacher training, assistive technologies, accessible educational materials, support services for these individuals. We also need to establish a robust systems for monitoring and evaluation for the implementation to check, you know, to audit the implementation of these dyslexia-related policies. So this may involve collecting data on key indicators, tracking progress, measuring outcomes, etc. We also need to do a lot of awareness and advocacy work. We need to raise awareness about dyslexia and advocate for the importance of addressing policy gaps to ensure equitable access to education and support service for these individuals. So doing this, doing awareness creation activities and doing advocacy related work may involve conducting public awareness campaigns, organizing advocacy events, collaborating with media outlets to disseminate information and to improve awareness and do advocacy. Finally, we need to do a lot of collaboration and partnership with similar organizations or entities sharing our cause, entities which have similar cause, the same cause as we have. We need to foster collaboration and partnership among government agencies, NGOs, educational agencies, institutions, community organizations, and other stakeholders to leverage resources, share expertise, and coordinate efforts in addressing dyslexia-related policy gaps. So having done all this, we also need to identify opportunities. So by taking these steps, policymakers and stakeholders can work together to bridge policy gaps and create an enabling environment that supports the educational success and well-being of children and adults with dyslexia in Africa. Once we are very clear with what we want to do, we need to also look for opportunities for policy advocacy. So identifying policy opportunities for policy advocacy requires a lot of work, but in particular, it involves at least a combination of doing a rigorous research, conducting a very good, well thought out analysis of the policy landscape and various factors we have discussed about. It also requires strategic thinking. We need to sit down and strategically plan how to navigate through the policy bureaucracy, the policy related barriers, factors, etc. So the roads to advocacy opportunities include using media outlets properly, media outlets, doing media outreach and public relations, utilizing media outreach and public relations strategies to raise awareness about dyslexia and advocate for policies change. We also need to write articles, letters to editors of newspapers, magazines, and we also need to prepare press releases and pitch stories to journalists to generate media coverage on dyslexia-related topics. We also need to do a very good public awareness campaigns, launching public awareness campaigns has to be done very well to enhance public education, to educate the general public about dyslexia, its symptoms, signs and symptoms and strength, not just the challenge, but we also need to demonstrate that dyslexia comes with lots of strengths as well. We need to use various platforms such as social media, websites, public events, traditional media, so on and so forth, to disseminate information and reach a wider audience. We need to also use personal stories and testimonies. We need to share personal stories and testimonials from individuals with dyslexia. We know that the personal stories are very powerful, and we will be able to get our ideas across very well by using personal stories and testimonials. Of course, we need to do a lot of partnership and coalitions. We also need to do various educational workshops and trainings. We need to do lobbying and advocacy. We need to empower parents and empower support groups within our communities. We need to do a lot of professional development courses, trainings for educators, parents, and other stakeholders who are directly working with children with dyslexia. Of course, we need to do a lot of research and data collection as well. So what are our opportunities to improve policy and practices related to dyslexia? Our opportunities include improving our education policies, improve our legislations and policies in general, policies related to education, health systems, social welfare, etc. We also need to improve policies and practices around teacher training and professional development. We need to improve parent education and support programs. We need to improve awareness and outreach in general. We also need to work on on improving our research and innovation practices and policies. We need to work on improving employment and workplace accommodation programs. We need to work on healthcare and access to service programs. We also need to improve community partnerships. We need to also